sir, and thank you to organizing committee, our seniors, and whole SCP India team. Our friends, discussion of today, that is little COVID and heart disease, I'm focusing especially on the cardiomyopathy. We know the dreaded complication of cardiovascular is when COVID started, it was initially like flu, but we know the what happened in second and third week when the cytokine storm started and everything's going on the management for the more and more cardiovascular diseases. A patient get recurrent and recurrent admission, even after the admission, there was a complication. I have so many patients that related to me, they were fully recovering. And ultimately, when they develop some thromboembolic complications, they develop pulmonary embolism, some kind of myocardial infarction, and ultimately difficult to survive. So, that complication is right now going on, but we are dealing with the chronic complication, and that is persisting, and people are coming with me for the echocardiographic evaluation, and they have shortness of breath, and when I'm going for some kind of stress test, even simple diastolic stress test, the test is coming positive and having a high filling pressure. So somehow echocardiographic evaluation was very important. If we see the spectrum of disease for the COVID, we know COVID in all kind of disease, it started from the pericardium, myocardium, muscle effort, cardiomyopathy, then micro and macrovascular disease, either in form of microvascular angina, some obstructive CAD. Only one kind of disease that not pertaining to COVID, that is the organic valvular stenosis. The COVID never reported this causes primary valvular stenosis in terms of either mitral, tricuspid, or pulmonary or aortic stenosis. Although secondary regurgitation was common with the COVID. So this is a spectrum of diseases, and the main problem in the second week on the 6 to 7 days was cytokine storm, and ultimately patient developed a tunnelage by HFrEF with reduced ejection fraction, EF is very low, and patient developed gross congestive cardiac failure and cardiogenic shock. This is a spectrum of why he started this. Started simply with some cytokine storm, and two things is there. One, either patient is get infected de novo with this COVID virus, or patient was having some already cardiovascular risk factor. If it was a risk factor, then they definitely this was become exponential. So started simply with the cytokine storm and some effect on this myocarditis. This patient started to develop not initially arrhythmia and complications to hypoxemia and some microvascular thromboembolic. This was a very common. That's why there is a concern to start NOAC in the very predominantly we started. And there's a guideline from ESC and SEC to start the NOAC. Even the prophylactically a different type of NOAC is there. And we are using and having a very good result in the secondary prophylaxis and prevention of thromboembolic complication. So micro and macrovascular disease, stress induced cardiomyopathy, tachosubo was observed, that was rarely, but when we get the for the same patient for this NGO and for the interrogation, it was just, NGO was normal, but that was rarely reported. Among the spectrum of disease, we see their cardiomyopathy, especially dilated cardiomyopathy with the COVID was the main concern. And this is the bidirectional lesion. One thing is that when patient is already having some cardiovascular disease, diabetes, hypertension, obstructive COPD. Second was on the same time patient having the COVID develop into this complication, or patient having already diseases and subsequently getting inoculated to COVID-19. Already the things started the same way that initially where they start to, we know the interaction with the ACE inhibitor that is well known in the domain. It started the cardiac injury, and troponin was the one marker that was a very big in the, that troponin level, temporal profile of troponin level up to 3 weeks was a very important to correlate with the comorbidity and a severity of disease. And 2-3 biomarker were very become strongly positive in terms of the cardiomyopathy, where is the troponin T, the NT-proBNP. And we know NT-proBNP is a hormone that is not related to damaged cardiomyocytes. This is released only when there is a shear force by Frank Starling law when the patient has cardiomyopathy, NT-proBNP level is high. Not just because of reduced pumping capacity, just because of increased shear forces and there is more release of NT-proBNP. So NT-proBNP subsequently become high, and this was observed during the course of treatment when the systolic function was improving, filling pressure was improving, the NT-proBNP was going down. This is some direct damage and some indirect hypoxemia and cytokine storm. They ultimately, the thing was same when patient is in front of us and on the couch, This is not easy to this came from which road, either indirect or direct damage. We need to determine the nature of disease and how to treat the patient. And especially to diagnose myocarditis, even without COVID, this is a sometimes challenge. Myocarditis is not simple. And if patient presented with like a SCS and you are getting, you see, non-specific changes quite early age of the patient, presented the myocarditis, cellular and internal arrhythmia, and thromboembolic complication. C4 biomarker become very, strong in that time. Even I was get infected with COVID. I remember my senior year, and I asked on the telephone, "Ma'am, kya kare?" And then she told me, "You got this," and I was correlating with this temporal profile of this biomarker, and believe me, as I was becoming better and better, this was going down. So this was really a wonderful, especially IL-6 and D-dimer. And D-dimer was somehow, even with the patient level, this was more provocating. Now my D-dimer is this, what to do with my pulmonary embolic complication. So myocardial injury can result in the associated cytokine storm manifested the elevated level of interleukin 6, ferritin, LDH, and D-dimer. These all are acute phase reacting. I mean, you cannot go and solely depend on this. This is very strong to relate with the clinically, because you know LDH and ferritin is acute phase reactant and rise in all. Even simple fair is rise. But somehow this interleukin 6 was more, things that we rely on this nature of disease and how the patient is progressing the disease are going to on the better side. There was acute phase and there was convalescent phase. Patient coming with us in the first week, okay, all right, this was a recommendation, nothing in India, but the patient is coming the second week, dropping down the saturation and having some shortness of it and having the comorbidity. Of course, we are asking the biomarker. In the biomarker, important was if patient is improving, no need to pay temporal profile, but if it is not improving, then temporal profile is needed. And on the same time, if patient developed chest pain, a symptom like chest pain and shortness of breath, then it was important to correlate with either patient developed no SPMI, non-SPMI, or just this because of microvascular complication or myocarditis. So there was the guideline that you will get all this biomarker. On the same time, you get ECG and echocardiography was the must. And sometimes T was indicated to rule out the wall motion abnormality. But the thing is, this is wall motion abnormality. This is just of because of recent origin or some old origin. This need to correlate with the biomarkers. If it is of old origin, biomarker were looking to be normal. In convalescent phase, definitely you're going for the ECG cardiac monitoring and risk factor. As I saw, CMR is, fascinating for this COVID management, and this was not available everywhere just for, doing the CMR. But one thing practically I was doing with my patient, doing echocardiography on the bedside, and at the same time, strain imaging, LG, global longitudinal strain, and it was showing to be alteration and simple by looking at the tissue Doppler transmetal full velocity and annular velocity. It was systolic functions were decreasing, annular velocity was reducing. So in this way, there was indirect correlation that is affecting the cardiomyocytes. This one, so this temporal profile of the troponin changes at a different time interval up to 3 to 4 weeks. If disease severity was going, the troponin T was increasing, and this was well correlated with the severity of disease. Systemic cardiovascular disease burden in COVID-19. This is a systemic review from the so many articles. And among this prevalence of different complication, hyper and hypotension was the one concern. But if you go for the organic heart disease in terms of myocardial damage, injury, coronary artery disease, so cardiomyopathy was a very important concern, especially when patient developed HFrEF, it reduced ejection fraction, dilated cardiomyopathy. Not always a reverse of it was reverting, but it was difficult to treat. Palpitation and frank heart failure were also concerned with this. So cardiomyopathy concern was that was around 7 different literature, pinpoint 7.3% is in the different literature. This quoted around 7 to 10% of patient having this cardiomyopathy. And if I'm telling cardiomyopathy, this is always dilated cardiomyopathy or ischemic cardiomyopathy with reduced systolic function, not the preserved or mid-range ejection fraction. This was not reported with COVID. Yes, cardiac comorbidity complication relevant mortality of the COVID-19 patient. I mean, the one thing was when we started to treat the patient of the COVID and we used those kind of medicine, ultimately also causes problem with the conduction defect and this myocarditis sort of thing. Simple macrolide antibiotic, what was the option? This causes some conduction abnormality, a supratherapeutic reason. So if we think of the comorbidity, hypertension and diabetes, cardiovascular disease, either it has obstructive CAD, non-obstructive CAD, all having this hyperlipidemia itself is a really, if you think of the common soil hypothesis, this is one concern. Someone in a very high LDN and is concomitantly there and get inoculated COVID-19, that might be one. So, but if you see the terminal complication was land a patient into arrhythmia, especially supraventricular arrhythmia was the dreaded in this patient, and then patient developed heart failure. With myocarditis, usually patient, because we are using steroid here and there in patient, because to treat the COVID itself, we are treating the COVID itself, but ultimately myocarditis was resolving. Otherwise, the normal patient, I mean, we are very particular to use the steroid in the myocarditis, even if it is a diagnosis, but in COVID era, we were free to use the steroid. Even the patient is diabetic, use here and there, and patient is improving, their myocarditis is improving. But when patient is land up into heart failure, that was not ultimately the thing, and that was a big challenge for all of us. This is some technique to diagnose this myocarditis. We know the 3 stages of changes of myocarditis from our UG time, and always our teacher was asking, and they try to retain the same classes or not able to see some early changes, mid changes, and later some steep changes. The problem was when you diagnose the myocarditis either by echocardiography, some diastolic dysfunction, and some abnormal septal movement, and some pericardial constraint. What to do? Even you go for the CMR and LDL, ultimately the things is just to maintain the vital oxygen saturation and use the steroid. So this was, I mean, one gift for us that in the COVID time you are using steroid very frequently and treating the thing. Current medication when we are using on that time right now, okay, we are free from that thing. So using hydroxychloroquine, we know their complication, this prolongation of QT interval and some arrhythmogenic complication, erythromycin. And more frequently, I will say remdesivir was used. And so even this causes, you know, this effect on the conduction pathway. So and low molecular weight, heparin itself having some very rare complication, but that is not a very use. But the two, three things is that erythromycin, ritonavir, lopinavir, and remdesivir, they was having some sort of cardiac complication, developing conduction defect in myocarditis. When patient land up into his frank heart failure, cardiac complications, so what was the outcome? Just to see the data when patient developed into heart failure and he was with the normal LV systolic function, there's a huge difference in the data. Without heart failure, outcome was very excellent. That was around 77 to 80%. But with the heart failure, frank heart failure, that we become pretty. Okay, I'm very fast. A laboratory finding, you know, the count was decreased and CK, LDS, IL-6, CRP, everything, you know. Elevated level of troponin T is associated with poor prognosis, as I explained. This was significant till third week because we know the troponin T level there, half-life was 14 to 15 days. So if the troponin anti-proBNP was increased, one was indicated our cardiomyocyte is damaging, and if the biomarker anti-proBNP is increasing, so the stress forces on this cardiomyocyte is getting stretched, and filling pressure is high, and both was strongly correlated to the outcome of the cardiovascular disease, especially cardiac complications and the COVID. And this is a flow diagram with the HF, go for the vital monitoring, see either bradyarrhythmia is there or no arrhythmia, maintain the fluid, maintain the fever, hypoxia, all these things. The important was there was a hype sometime initially used a face and ARM, and that was subsequently proven that there is no concern, you can use according to your needed. And in this group of ARNI and with the HFrEF patient, there was no indication to use in this kind of patient because usually this patient was hemodynamically unstable. But the other group of medicine like beta blocker and ACE and ARB, we are using the frequently in this kind of patient. So this again, meta review, I will leave it. I explain this one. So this is a one thing, either patient of COVID-19 develop STEMI, then what to do? Answer was only one need to go for a pharmaco-invasive strategy. Primary intervention, primary angioplasty was not concerned on that time. Subsequently, they developed the protocol, but the where we work in the secondary and even the tertiary care center, not everywhere primary angioplasty is available. So you evaluate the patient, the biomarker, you see change history, and the positive, then you go for a pharmacoinvasive strategy, you thrombolyze the patient, make stabilize the patient, in between then you plan for this. But I think that just to summarize, in my words, that COVID-19, when it was on the phone blown, having some great complications, and myocardial injury was an important concern in more than 25% of cases. With all variety of diseases with that related to heart, especially I told them this valve heart disease, and cardiomyopathy was the one complication that need to revert, even if I hope this will not come again. So we should be cautious about this. Thank you. This all from myself.